Association with the Dalit Cultural Club. My name is Shabir Razvi. I'll be hosting the program and have the privilege of hosting the program this evening. And without doubt, these programs could not be organized without Brother Dr. Saeed Shahabi and Fatima Dosa. I'd like to thank both of them and also our speakers. I'll introduce the program speedily so that I can give 20 minutes each to the speakers, and then we have a good half an hour for Q&A. As you all know, after the mayoral elections and other elections, the next election on the agenda is this European Union election, which is due and scheduled on 23rd of June. So not long ago, not far from today, UK has to decide whether it will remain within the European Union or opt out. This is the biggest decision in recent decades and will have profound impact on the European alliance. Both camps are engaged in relentless efforts to convince the people to vote on their side. Today, we've had both Mr. Brown and Mr. Boris Johnson throwing in their hat on two opposite sides of the spectrum. Both sides of the Atlantic are awaiting the outcome of the decision by the British people, which will have ramifications on immigration, economy, international relations, human rights, and cultural integration of the continent. It is an opportunity to participate in the decade which affects the lives of those living in the British Isles. We've got three eminently suitable speakers today to really decipher what is fact and what is fantasy. There's debate going on both sides, and also recent articles that the European Union was a CIA project. Whether that's another conspiracy theory or whether there's any truth in it also is a fascinating thought in itself. May I request our first guest to make his presentation? He's a national treasurer for the Stop the War Coalition and campaigns officer for the Palestine Solidarity Campaign. He's a member of the Labour Party. Dare I say, if you're anti-Zionist, would you stay in the Labour Party at this moment? Stephen. Stephen Gwellen, please welcome Stephen in a moment.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I'd like, obviously, thank the Gulf Cultural Club for the invitation. It's always a privilege to speak here, and it's always a delight to listen and take part in these discussions. Just to stress, of course, that I'm not, although I'm an officer of both Stop the War and the Palestine Solidarity Campaign, I'm not speaking on their behalf tonight. Both organisations have different views on these questions with, amongst the membership. So, I'll be speaking in favour of a vote to remain a member of the EU. But first, I think it's important to stress, I actually don't think that the issue of the European Union is the decisive question facing Britain today. I think that the decisive issue is the defence of living standards of the population and the struggle against austerity. At the moment, we have the really key debate, in my opinion, is what is the alternative to the Conservatives' austerity policy, which is hampering economic growth. People may well have noticed that manufacturing has gone back into recession, and reducing the real income of the majority of the population. Alongside this, cuts in social services and welfare provision are inflicting misery upon the most vulnerable sections of our society. So, in my view, inside or outside of the EU, we'll need to struggle for an alternative economic policy to that being pursued by our government. That said, the referendum is upon us and we have to address this question. Now, I think from the start, the decision to call a referendum was a political manoeuvre from Cameron as a way of unifying the Conservative Party before the general election. The Tory Party is full of people who are nostalgic for the British Empire and who cannot accept the decline of British imperialism. These are the people who believe that you just have to have some assertion of national identity and the world will be deeply impressed. In Cameron's manoeuvre, by saying that he would call a referendum after negotiations, renegotiations of Britain's treaty obligations, basically allowed him to say to both wings of the Conservatives, those in favour and those against, that if they supported him, they'd both have a chance of winning their policy later on, and that's where we are now. The first thing to register is that the negotiations that Cameron has conducted have essentially changed nothing fundamental, either in the terms of new obligations for Britain or new exclusions for Britain from the EU. Instead, we have seen Cameron concentrating on issues such as excluding some new EU migrants from in-work benefits. Now, apart from the obvious spitefulness and pettiness of this, it's not actually going to affect a large number of people. The denial of in-work benefits for the first few years is a small number of families, but even then, this year's introduction of the National Living Wage will lift a number of those families on you know, it's a new minimum wage essentially. We're lifting up workers out of what will be welfare qualifications anyway. So we've seen a great deal of rhetoric for very little achievement. It was always a maneuver, it was always about getting through the election. There's no change on the fundamental issues, such as the nature of the single market, or the movement, free movement of labour, or anything of substance. But he's had his negotiations, and now we are facing the vote. Now, as a socialist, I approach this from the point of view of whether leaving or staying benefits working people, benefits and poorer people in our society. And at present, without making, at present, I believe, withdrawal would make some difference to the position of working people in this country, worsen their position, not improve it. I think there's a number of reasons why this is the case. Firstly, trade with the EU is very large. 47% of our trade last year was with other EU countries. Now, withdrawal would lead to a disruption in this. Of course, one has to be realistic. Both parties, both trading parties, have an interest in maintaining that trade, and they would find a way to restore it. There would be some dislocation. It wouldn't be lost. It would be disrupted. However, on the issue of inward investment, there will be a genuine loss. A great deal of inward investment into Britain comes to the from outside the UK, and it's premised on the fact that UK is a member of the EU, and therefore you're investing in the Britain, you have access to the EU market without tariff. So withdrawal then would lead to a considerable loss of investment and inevitably some impact upon jobs. I think in addition, the restrictions on immigration and migration generally from withdrawal would be very, very serious indeed. I mean, firstly, I think it's important to register that the migration of labour and the free movement of labour has been very helpful for this country and very helpful for the economy. According to the EU, EU migrants have contributed £20 billion to the UK economy between 2001 and 2011. That's according to the University of London report. The automatic right of EU citizens to enter Britain and vice versa, Britons to move into other EU countries, would finish. On top of this, the most racist and aggressive xenophobic forces in British society, those in UKIP, in the far right, and the racists in the Tories, would be hugely encouraged by withdrawal and would be setting the agenda on these questions for some time to come. There is also a very specific impact in terms of the impact on Ireland, where under the peace process and the Good Friday Agreement, there is a very free movement between north and south in Ireland. And the suggestion that new border controls would now operate between the north and south would have a very, very disastrous effect on the whole peace process. In Ireland, and is extremely hostile view amongst the majority of Irish people to withdrawal because of that fact. There would be also a reduction in trade union and human rights under a number of protective legislation which currently exists. For instance, the EU Working Time Directive provides protection to workers on the length of their working week. This week, the TUC provided a report indicating that a million workers could be forced to work more than 48 hours a week if Britain was excluded from this provision. On top of that, there'd also be, in my view, a loss of cooperation on issues such as environmental protection and the struggle against climate change. So, without having gone into great detail, I think the immediate economic and political case are in favour of remaining. But I'd like to spend basically the rest of what I've got to say reviewing the EU's relationship with North Africa, the Middle East and the Gulf. I think the EU policy on these questions tends to be more progressive than the Foreign and Commonwealth Office. If Britain withdraws, then on balance, I think US policy goals would figure even more strongly than they do in the UK's foreign policy. If you look at currently the EU's policy to North Africa and Middle East has two main objectives. Firstly, through European neighbourhood policy to encourage support, political and economic reform in each country that has a relationship with the EU. Secondly, through the Union of the Mediterranean to promote regional cooperation. So currently, under the European neighbourhood policy, the EU is organising Operation Sophie, which claims to have saved 13,000 lives in rescue operations of migrants in the Mediterranean. The same policy is also promoting with the UN peace talks and a ceasefire for Yemen. And finally, promoting a new government in Libya with support by humanitarian and other not-so-humanitarian means. Now, currently under the Union of the Mediterranean, which is also called the Barcelona process, the EU initiatives include work on common efforts to depollute the Mediterranean, joint programmes on national disasters, promotion of alternative energy programme and support for small and medium enterprises. Now, alongside these two major objectives of EU policy, there's a number of major diplomatic initiatives. The EU is part of the quartet, along with the US, Russia and the UN, in promoting negotiations on Palestine and Israel. The EU has extensive relations with the Gulf Cooperation Council. The Gulf Cooperation Council is the EU's fifth largest export market with $97 billion in 2014. The EU is the biggest trading partner with the GCC, $152 billion in trade flows, euros that is. And there are cooperation on with the GCC on issues of clean energy, security, education, scientific research, etc., etc. Alongside these, the EU has a series of bilateral relations with Iran, Iraq, and Yemen. On Iran, the EU, of course, made a significant contribution to the negotiations for the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action and the lifting of sanctions against Iran from January the 16th this year. On Iraq, they have a specific partnership and cooperation agreement which mirrors the fact that 16.2 billion euros of trade with the EU being Iraq's second largest trading partner after the US. And there was various humanitarian programs, up to 106 million offered euros offered in 2015 for internally displaced persons, refugees from Syria and so on. On Yemen, there is a cooperation agreement. In the past, there has been 300 million euro programs on food and security. There's assistance at the moment with new development program, and there's a very extensive trade. Now, I accept, and I like much EU policy, some of these policies and programs are ambiguous, and their value for the people of the Middle East and the Gulf is questionable and debatable. I think that's true of a great deal of EU policy, both in its external relations and in its internal relations. But my point is that the extent of these relations should be a factor in our consideration of issues and the EU referendum. I prefer to see British citizens exercising pressure through EU institutions and upon the British government on these programmes, rather than completely cutting ourselves off from them. So in summary, the EU has many strengths and many, many weaknesses. In my opinion, at this point in time, for the purpose of the benefit of working people in this country and for the benefit of our international relations, I believe the thing to do is to vote Remain and continue to struggle for those issues which we know are fundamentally of importance.
Thank you, Thank you for sticking to your allocated time. We do appreciate that. Our next speaker
is a political commentator who is critical of the international finance system. He's a Muslim convert and a Sufi of the Naqshbandi Haqqani Tariqah. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. Perhaps he's also a traditionalist and political monarchist on the right of the political spectrum. He holds critical views on the international banking system, which he considers is the chief source of evil of the world. Please kindly welcome our next guest speaker, Alan Newport.
Okay, well, the last point that Al-Shem made about my criticism of the international banking system is, of course, not, strictly speaking, an EU matter. But it is, in the sense, it's tangential anyway, because the bigger the organisation that we have to deal with, the more difficult it is to get anything done at all. And that really comes onto the matter of sovereignty and the ability to make any impact whatsoever on this, on this enormous labyrinthine organisation, which is more or less impenetrable for most people. And judging by David Cameron's inability to actually renegotiate anything of any substance, it would appear that it's fairly difficult for him also. It would seem that once the arrangements within the... Once decisions have been made, it would seem that nothing much can be changed without a great deal of difficulty, and that's the problem, because these rules are made in secret. In fact, the whole EU agenda has been a secret agenda made by the elites, part of the post-war agreement, and it is part of, really, when it comes to it, it's part of the American sphere. You can see that because of Obama's comments when he's saying, you know, we'll be at the back of the queue. And this is mostly the Remain argument, that if we don't remain, then we'll be pushed around and our money will be taken away and there'll be fewer jobs and all this kind of thing. Nothing is really proven in respect of this. Maybe there will be some costs. Maybe there will be some benefits. It's an immensely complex issue. And I don't feel I'm really able to work it all out. There are people who have detailed opinions, and good luck to them, because they obviously devote a great deal of time to it. One of them is Robert Holmes. If anyone would like to know some detailed reasons for leaving the EU, then his book on the EU is a very good place to start, very detailed. Historically, the EU has been, as I said before, a secretive organisation. It was put together by people behind the scenes and implemented in a covert kind of way, and then the people are presented with it as a fait accompli. There is very little discussion of the issues before they come to the fore, and then usually they're pushed through with a kind of propaganda device where people are persuaded by using platitudes and cliches and threats and inducements and all sorts, none of which have very much to do with what actually goes on. A good example is the fisheries industry, one of the first casualties of this monster, where our fisheries industry was destroyed basically by overfishing and then quotas and then throwing back dead fish and all the rest of it. We all know about some of the grotesque distortions of common sense that occurred there. But we basically got nothing from that agreement. We were supposed to have access to Norwegian waters, but then the Norwegians decided they didn't want to have anything to do with it, and so we didn't have that. It was a farce, and there had been many farces of this kind, because when you're dealing with something as complex as 22 nations trying to agree on anything, you're liable to get this kind of thing occurring, especially when you don't know what's going on behind the scenes. I know you don't know what's going on behind the scenes in Westminster either, but it's a bigger, more complex, same kind of situation. That's the objection to the EU, actually, when it comes to it. It's more of the same, bigger of the same, and more complex and more difficult to access. But it is, in many ways, more or less the same thing as we've got, more or less the same thing that everybody has got. One of the things that we've got is a completely corrupt financial system where money is produced out of nothing. It leads to boom and bust situations. We are often presented with, last time in 2008, we were presented with an enormous bill to bail out the positions of speculators, basically. And nothing has changed, and we are in for another massive collapse in the financial system. What will happen then? I don't know. There'll be all sorts of things, but the smaller man, the man at the bottom, will be paying for it, not the plutocratic international banking class. The other big issue is, of course, migration and the loss of control over borders. It is not true that working people benefit from migration at all. Incidentally, this is not racist, because, of course, many working people in this country now are not of European descent, and they won't be benefiting from mass migration either. Migration lowers wages and it increases costs. Just look at the situation where people now, working people, cannot afford anywhere to live, anywhere near London, and that's where the jobs are. At the same time, of course, people who are in need, this peculiar idea that to each according to his needs and from each according to his ability, seems to have taken root somehow with the equality mongers who seem to think that equality is some kind of new religion. And they will be accommodated according to their need, whereas those who actually support the economy, support the funds that goes to people who live on other people, have to commute for miles on crowded trains, exhaust themselves. This kind of situation cannot continue, and we're going to have a systemic collapse if it continues, if common sense and traditional ways of viewing things are continually eroded by what is in fact a false religion. And that's what the EU is all about in the end. It's more of the same, it's much more powerful, it is monolithic, and any idea that we can somehow reverse some of the unfortunate modern trends will be even further from being a possibility. A few points on specifics. It's just been announced that apparently the Americans and the EU have been in negotiation to secretly coordinate their regulatory frameworks in relation to the TTIP agreements, which appear to be some kind of agreement whereby the corporatists have the right to sue European governments if they don't behave in a way that suits them, basically. And there's another one that's recently been announced that whistleblowers can now be prosecuted, apparently, for exposing things that corporations do. It's part of a copyright law. I don't suppose anybody understood anything like this was actually on the agenda, because once again, it's something that happens behind the scenes. It all happens behind the scenes, and then suddenly we're presented with it and we have to comply. I'm not in a position to enumerate the number of things that have been destroyed in this way. A number of small firms that have gone out of business somehow. I can give you one example, a trivial example perhaps, but maybe it serves as a good example nonetheless. And that's the Elderflower Champagne Company. Used to sell a soft drink that was called Elderflower Champagne. They were bought through the courts for calling it champagne. Well, they went bust. There was no need for it, but there was absolutely no consideration for that small company. And that's the kind of thing that happens when you have a body the size of Europe, with the power of Europe, that's the EU, that is, who are able to pursue their agendas through the courts and crush smaller people.
Now, again, the issue of migration, this has been brought up by the previous speaker. It is again not a matter of racism to realise that a continually rising population is not good for people. It is said that it raises GDP. Well, of course it does. But GDP is a peculiar metric that has some very strange characteristics. For instance, if I go to a bank, borrow money, buy some Chinese goods, and in a couple of years throw them on the landfill, that increases GDP. GDP is a measure of so-called economic activity. It is not a measure of priority for ordinary people. And we notice that that since 2008 and the economic collapse, the vast majority of new money has flowed to the very tiniest top of the global population, whilst ordinary people have actually suffered a diminution in their livelihood, and this is a situation that's liable to continue because that's where the power is. It's basically financial power structure where those at the top benefit enormously, far more than they did in the past with an aristocracy, which is often seen as being unjust and oppressive. Well, this is far more oppressive. It is a global aristocracy. It is secret, and it is more powerful than the previous one, and it doesn't have to take very much account of the people at all. The control of the people's minds through the press and the media is more or less total. They can get us to believe whatever they like, and they do so. They get us to believe that the constant undermining of ordinary people's assumptions and ways of being is perfectly okay on the basis of some kind of socialist principles, like equality, for instance, like multiculturalism, for instance. Multiculturalism is a peculiar idea that people of very disparate backgrounds, races, cultures and religions can all kind of live together, and there won't be the inevitable kind of friction which will lead to conflict, which will lead to a more oppressive state and the loss of a kind of organic self-government. Incidentally, of course, I'm not criticising immigrants in this because they are not responsible for it. They're simply responding for inducements that have been given by the European governments. The people drowning in the Mediterranean, for instance, are doing so because they are being offered inducements to do so. If you can make the journey, if you can risk your life and possibly those of your children, which of course you need because that gives you points in order to get the goodies, if you can make that journey and take those risks, then you will be rewarded. Also, of course, Western governments, and I know this doesn't just mean the EU, but they take some of the responsibility, are busy making the Middle East an intolerable inferno and a place of great suffering. It is an absolute disgrace. It isn't going to improve by us staying in the EU or leaving the EU, but it does mean that we can influence any decisions that Europe may make less, because once again it's a massive organisation and it is very remote. I think that's more or less covered.
Thank you very much. Putting the perspective on the table. I have immense pleasure to introduce our next speaker. He's a special advisor to the Secretary General of the Muslim Council of Britain on business and economic affairs and a tutor on MCB's leadership development programme. In the late 80s, he was editor-in-chief of Afkar, a groundbreaking news and analysis journal published in London. His current interests are in Islamic and moral finance. He was awarded the CBE in 2005 Queen's Honours List for services to international development. And on a personal note, it's always a pleasure to introduce Brother Iqbal Asaria, because I regard him as my teacher, my mentor, and it gives me great privilege to be sitting on the same rostrum as him. Please welcome Professor Dr. Iqbal Asaria for his presentation.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum and good evening. Thank you very much, Shabir, for that undeserved introduction. We've had two interesting presentations. What I want to do is to try to see if we can take a much more forensic view of what is at stake here. If you go back to the end of the Second World War, we see that Europe had, in the two wars, lost about 40 million people. And both sides, Britain, Germany, France, all of them were really on their knees economically. There was no question of victory in the sense of you had won properly. Everybody was exhausted and devastated. Now, in that situation, the United States took a very strategic decision that if we inject sufficient resources into rebuilding Europe and Japan, eventually these markets will benefit us. So it's a much more long-term vision. With that in view, apart from their own resources, they also established what is now known as the World Bank, but it was actually established as the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development of Europe and Japan. Later on, other countries joined. It had a wider mandate. That was its original mandate. And really it is from that date where we see the beginning of American investment. The United States obviously was spared all the ravages of the two wars, so they had everything going for them. And they inherited what we could not manage. But they did not abuse that for a long time to come. They did a lot of strategic planning and thinking and building Europe. And then obviously Europe became their biggest market. There were other issues here which we are not really able to integrate into the narrative, which is the Cold War and the rise of communism and the control of communism and so on. Where again, the United States provided a security umbrella to Europe from rising power in the Soviet Union at that time. So we must not forget that sometimes a long-term vision can create sustainable gains for us. The second thing to understand is that as a country, we are not a poor country. We are amongst the top five wealthiest countries in the world. So we cannot plead poverty to say that we cannot do anything. We are one of the wealthiest countries. We have to be able to see beyond our very short-term gains. Now, the idea of Europe obviously originated in the desire to avoid any further wars in Europe, because we had seen the cost of the wars. And we had found things which were really not acceptable. The idea was that if we have economic transfers between countries at different levels of economic development, eventually over a period of time, many of them will converge and therefore provide vast markets for goods and services which we make. Right? And as our colleague already referred to, close to 50% of our trade now is with Europe. And I suspect that about a quarter of that is with the new countries of Europe.
other than the established European countries like France and Germany. And more of trade will come in that way. So if we are at the moment making a net contribution to Europe, which I don't think we are actually, but even if we are, it is only building our long-term gain. Just like the Americans, if you think ahead, you see that this is building our own future. The next thing to think about is that although we are complaining about other EU citizens coming to work and live here, we must remember that we are essentially an aging society. If you look at the demographics of the United Kingdom, you see that on the one hand, we have a falling birth rate, and on the other hand, we have a population which is living longer than ever. Every 10 years, we are adding a couple of years to the longevity. So in fact, at the moment, if you are an insurance sponsor and you go for an annuity for women, they calculate the annuity assuming that an average woman will live to 90 plus. All right? And the average man will live to 87 or 88. So if that is a profile which insurance actuaries are adopting, that is what we are looking forward to pricing these products and so on. However, on the other hand, the model which we have developed now, which is not part of the European problem, but part of our problem, is that we have a totally unfunded pensions system, which means that the contributions of the young and able workers go straight into financing the pensions and benefits of the retired people. If you have a falling number of young people working and a rising number of people living longer, you can see that the sums do not add up and they have a problem. We're trying to fiddle around with that by saying we will increase the retirement age to 68 and 70. And how far can go? You can't push everybody to work to 75. It's simply not physically possible. So the only way is to find a new cohort of young people to work and contribute in their whatever national insurance contributions or whichever way they do. And that is where the immigration debate, as my colleague again pointed out, if you look at the economics of it, pure economics, is a positive factor because it does give us a break. Unfortunately, the numbers required for that to work perfectly are too large for our society to absorb. I calculated about 10 years ago the numbers for Europe. I came to the conclusion that Europe as a whole, EU 26 as it is today, will require an additional 45 million people to immigrate to bring that balance. The United Kingdom will require about 5 million more. So clearly these numbers are difficult to digest. But if you look at the core reality of economics, that's what you need to do to live comfortably. Otherwise, you have an aging population which will find it difficult to fund itself. And we will have increasing acrimony and discomfort. However, this is not something which is going to be settled by either remaining in Europe or getting out of Europe. This is a function of the changing nature of our economy. As my colleague has pointed out, at the heart of it is austerity. And at the heart of austerity is the nature of finance capital. Those of you who have been lucky to read the work of Thomas Piketty, his book, which is called Capital in the 21st Century, which was the bestseller last year. I mean, can anybody imagine that a 700-page economics book becomes a bestseller, New York Times bestseller? It must have struck a chord. What Piketty is saying is that finance capital finally has delivered a system which has inverted the amount of profits going to labor and that going to capital. In stable times, the situation is that 60% or two-thirds roughly goes to labor and one-third goes to capital. Over the last 30 years, two-thirds is now going to capital and one-third is going to labor. And therefore the share of labor is going down. And this is clearly creating instability. Those of you who are working as professionals, teachers, doctors, so you will see that, for example, in the last 10 years, your salaries would hardly have changed. Yes, Nabila?
Yes.
So, effectively, you are poorer by 30%. And you will see you can't afford suddenly things which you were able to take for granted. Now, most people try to bridge that gap by borrowing. And that's why we have an increase in consumer debt. Unsustainable. Now, there's a limit to how far you can go, and as our friend said, there might be a crash on that structure at any point in time, which will make the problem worse, not better. This is the problem. So, again, this has nothing to do with Europe. In fact, Europe has been trying to rein back finance capital. It's the City of London which has been pushing for freedom for finance capital. So if we go out, we will become worse in this aspect. This is my feeling. The next thing is that across Europe, and you must remember that one of the most, I think one of the most honorable social organization of modern times is the social welfare state. And this is a typical European invention. Most countries in Europe have one variant or another, and that's why Europe was able to sort of sustain itself and grow. Because again of the pressure from finance capital, the social welfare state is coming under pressure.
Yep.
Taxation levels are being brought down. You've seen the recent Panama files that wealth is being used without taxing. We've seen big corporations here paying no taxes and so on. So the tax base is eroded. Therefore, the state cannot support that level of activity. That is again contributing to a perverse kind of adversity. If you go out of Europe, the tendency in Britain is going to be even worse than it is today. The European kind of peer pressure, if nothing else, is enough to keep us there. We are in between the United States and Europe, but we could go much more towards the United States, where 20 to 25% of the people have no safety net at all. Okay. Now, in terms of trade and agriculture, clearly we have a big relationship with Europe, nearly half our trade. Plus, what we don't know is that our agriculture is fully supported by subsidies, payments from the European Union. So the common agricultural policy supports most farms. And if you are not careful of this, we could lose a lot of our farmers. They will go out of business if they don't get these kind of subsidies. We also have large numbers of subsidies for keeping our green spaces green. for the people who maintain them and so on. This is all, these are all European initiatives. They are not British initiatives. Because if we had it our way, we would long ago have done with them. On trade, there is also another aspect which is very specific. And that is that with the single market, you have free access to the whole market and more. You have, for example, something which we call a passporting regulation. If you have a product, financial product or anything else in this country, you can market that product across Europe without additional permission from any European state. Which means, effectively, you have a Europe-wide market for your product. So if you have the ability and the vision, something quite possible to capitalize on in a big way. So all these things we need to put into one basket and see where we are. The next thing, as Michael, you again said, and I think this needs repeating, that a lot of multinationals, say Japanese car firms, American companies, have based their European operations in the United Kingdom with the understanding that this will be a base from which the whole of Europe will be serviced. That's why our car industry is bigger and growing. Our other industries are also growing in that sense. If we got out of the single market, okay, we will reach an understanding, but nobody is going to allow you a free entry into their space unless you offer reciprocity, which means why are you doing this in any case? You are already having this, so why do you want to do that, right? So I think that's another thing which needs bearing on. Finally, there is one thing which I think I haven't seen being mentioned anywhere else. We know that on the global scene, the balance of economic power between the East and West is shifting. So the sort of share of global trade or all kinds of other statistics from India and China are rising and will rise. Eventually this will lead, and this is already leading, to a demand for change in the balance of power in international institutions. So whether is it voting rights for the International Monetary Fund or the World Bank or so on, we will have to fight our cover. Now just look at the UN Security Council. At the moment, two EU members are permanent members of the Security Council, France and the United Kingdom. Now, if you go out of the EU, in 10 years this debate is coming, and they say we need to give, for example, India a seat on the government, as a permanent member. Will they check out the EU or will they check out the United Kingdom alone? I don't think it is a no-brainer. We will be out of the top table before we know it. So I think if you add up all these things, you can see that there is an overwhelming case for us to say we want to remain in, but we want to make a difference to how the EU bureaucracy and structure works. Up to now, we haven't applied ourselves seriously to that business. Not many of us know French. Every Frenchman knows English. Every German knows English. You go to the continent, you find it very easy to communicate. When they come here, we struggle. When we go to these huge EU meetings, there are translations in 26 languages and so on, you get lost. Clearly, but lost, we need to speak some key languages and understand their cultures. So, we need, if we engage seriously, we can make a difference because we have a lot of experience, we have depth, we have institutions which can contribute. And we have culture. We have a culture which can really show Europe some of the things we still need to show. Okay. The last thing is that we have seen in the recent crisis on refugees from Syria, from North Africa, and everywhere, that all the borders of Europe are really volatile. If we do not invest collectively as Europe in those countries and make those countries viable and offer jobs to their people, which they feel are reasonable, we will be swamped. Not because we allow the immigration from Europe, but because people will just find ways to swim more clearly and cleverly across the sea. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Brother Balasaria. I'll open the floor for questions. We have a few comments, I think, from Dr. James, if you'd be kind enough to
Comments on the basis of my main concerns, one of which is peace and war, and particularly Europe and Britain and America's wars in the Middle East. And so I'm concerned about the effect of leaving or staying in Europe from that point of view. My main piece of evidence comes from a meeting that's going to be held tomorrow in an obscure place actually, but it's near Houston. And it's held by the EuroPAL. They've commissioned a document called the Israel Lobby and the European Union, which basically describes how the Israeli lobby has not only gripped the United Kingdom and, of course, America by the throat and got it to wage wars against Islam. But it's doing the same thing in Europe as well, in quite a big way. And so I agree with the speaker who said that this was possibly, Europe was possibly a CIA plot. I don't know whether that's actually true, but it's certainly true that Henry Kissinger said about 30 or 40 years ago, when I want to call Europe, who do I call? This was before Europe had really become established in the way it is now. In other words, the chief warmonger in the world wanted one person to talk to and persuade, rather than to persuade all the other countries. Now, if he wants that, I question it. In other words, let's make it difficult for the warmongers, and let's stay as independent as we can. Let's keep the decision making as close to our personal interests, which are good neighbours, peace with our friends, peace generally, whether they're friends or not. We don't want to encourage wars. We don't want to destroy other people's countries. We don't want to take their land. And frankly, we don't want them coming here saying, you've destroyed our country, now we want a piece of yours. And it's a bit of an unfair characterization of what's happening in Syria now, but I think that's the truth. We've damaged, virtually destroyed Iraq. The Sunni people from Iraq were actually marched out by the American administrator, Paul Bremer, in 2004, because he said they're not to have any official positions. 4 million of them, at least 800,000 went to Syria. It's quite possible that they really wanted to get back to their homes and their country and have established, in my view, an Islamic caliphate as a way of getting some kind of force together so that they can exert some pressure against the Israeli hegemony in the area, which it leads to my second major document in this debate, which is the new strategy for securing the realm, called A Clean Break, written by Richard Perle, Paul Wolfowitz, endorsed by Netanyahu, and a number of other of the well-known neocons in 1996. And that was then translated by the neocons in America to an American document called Rebuilding America's Defenses. And it didn't actually specify, but this does specify that Syria and five other Muslim countries will have to be military occupied because they present a threat basically to Israel. And it was then translated to mean it would be a threat, they'd be a threat to the West. And so that became there in the year 2000 when they published the American document, Partnership for the Rebuilding of America's Defenses, when that was published, on page 50, it said, and it's attributed to Rabbi Dov Zakheim, who wrote an article about the same issue, the American public will never accept this strategy unless we had a major incident, catastrophic incident, such as a new Pearl Harbor. A year later, 9/11 happened. My view is that the Israelis were very much involved in that. This is straying a bit from me, but the point is that this power is taking over Europe, and my general fear is that we'll be more susceptible to that takeover, because it'll be a much bigger and more remote organisation than it is at the moment, albeit we're very much part of that lobby now. But we still have a chance, because of being a so-called democracy, of changing that. So that's my main thing. And there are one or two comments that I'd like to make, if there's time, on what's already been said.
I'd like to take questions.
Yes, indeed.